Yo, this is Teresa Weatherspoon, better known as Teaspoon, and you're watching Real Fans, Real Talk.
Face facts, what up?
RealFansRealTalk.com, where Arthur Thomas, Trip Young, and intern Tom for the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend a CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. RealFansRealTalk.com got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Did Jeremy Lin hurt?
Well, log on to the site and you can hear it from them first. I'm talking about the latest. I'm talking about the greatest. Go check out the archives. Even tell a neighbor. Tell them Bobby sent ya. From spring to winter. Tuning in should be the only thing on your agenda. Certified cosign. You know what I'm about, son. RealFansRealTalk.com. I'm out. One. Real fans. Real talk. Real fans. Real talk. RealFansRealTalk.com. RealFansRealTalk.com. Real fans. Real talk. Real fans. Real talk. RealFansRealTalk.com. RealFansRealTalk.com.
Chuck Young, Real Fans, Real Talk. The interview that you have all been waiting for. We came all the way from New York to get this man right here, the current WBC heavyweight champion of the world, Deontay Wilder. What's going on? Welcome to the show.
What's going on, brother, man? Y'all came all the way to Alabama.
I mean, we had to come visit the champ. So now, I know we're talking about the being positive and staying positive. I want to go back again to the Olympics now. You didn't get the gold, you got the bronze. So how did you re-motivate yourself to keep going and not giving up?
Well, you know, sometimes things don't go as planned, you know, and when things don't go as planned, you have to be a chameleon, you know, you got to adapt, you know what I'm saying, to life, because life brings so many things your way, so many different sizes and shapes and stuff. Life evolves into so many different kinds of things, man, and you just got to know how to adapt to well, maybe, you know, this didn't work out, so, hey, I got to go to plan B or plan C. Some people don't look past plan A. So, and that's what people get detoured, their mind, like, dang, they were so focused on plan A working that they couldn't really think about plan B. So, you just have to, you gotta train for the best, but think for the worst, you know what I mean? And that's what I've done, you know. I was just happy to be at the Olympics, you know, let alone as far as medaling, because I didn't supposed to be there. You're looking at a guy that, you know, they ain't even supposed to make it, you know, past a national level, let alone being it. Nobody has me picked, and nobody has this guy from Alabama picked to be an Olympian. You know, they had so many other guys that was supposed to fulfill my spot, you know, but God had the last say so about that.
I got to say, the heavyweight division has been lacking for a little while, and it hasn't been the same since the 90s, but now we got the new talent in, we're coming in, we got, you know, Deontay Wilder, you have arrived, and we're going to your last fight now. Now we're going up into the Stavern fight. Mm-hmm. People question your stamina. They question the chin. Yeah. They didn't know if you was gonna be able to keep up with that boy in the ring. And you proved a whole lot of people wrong. Dominated from the beginning to the end of the fight. And you see to the victor goes the spoils. What's going through your mind when your hand is being raised in that ring and it's the new heavyweight champion of the world, Deontay Wilder?
You know, first off, I made a lot of people a lot of money, and I made a lot of people lose a lot of money. So, the lesson learned for those that lost money, don't bet against me. Bet with me to make money. You know, we all about making money. But, you know, to answer your question, the first thing that went through my mind was, like, wow, you know, the fact when I went back to iterate it on how I promised my daughter that I'd be a world champion. That's the first thing that came to my mind. Like, I fulfilled that promise, because as a child, I was promised a lot of things, but nothing was fulfilled for me. You know, I had to go out and get it on my own, which made me a better man, which made me who I am now, a hard worker, super hard worker at that. But that was something I promised to her, and when I was able to fulfill it, it did my heart well. Even when I returned home, my daughter was like, said, Dad, she said she's proud of me. And it made my heart feel good, because most of the time, as fathers or as mothers, we tend to tell our children that we're proud of them, not have it reversed on us. And then for the child to say they're proud of you. So that was an awesome feeling right there, first and foremost. And another great feeling. Second, after that, I was like, you know, I was excited to be the first American heavyweight in what, 6 to 8 years or so, you know, to bring the WBC back to America. And be crowned, And along with that, on the side of that, was able to do it with on one of my favorite fighters of all time birthday, and that's Muhammad Ali, 73rd birthday. That was amazing. You know, so much was going on. Then it was Martin Luther King birthday as well too. Like it was so much going on January 17th that it was like it was impossible for me to lose.
Mark the Stat Man Skevich, Trip Young had a great interview with him. It's going to be a tough act to follow. I'm here with the world heavyweight champion of the world, Deontay Wilder. Thanks for coming on the program.
Thank you, man. Thank you for coming down.
All right. And like I said, tough act to follow. Trip Young covered a lot of your career. You're following Shannon Briggs, who was the last to hold a heavyweight championship in America. How does it feel as far as on a Patriot level, representing America in the Olympics, being the first heavyweight champion since 2007? How does that make you feel?
I feel great it's an awesome feeling. Due to the fact that I got the WBC belt, you know. Shannon never had the WBC belt. He wish he had it, but he don't. Sorry. He's on the side. You know, I'm not falling behind. He's on the side, and I just passed him with the WBC belt, baby. But, but it feel good to bring the belt back to America and stuff like that. And I'm just looking for more. I want all the belts, man. That's the next step. You know, I don't think it's no division that have a unified champion, that somebody that has all of them. And that's my next goal, is to unify the division and bring it back. I think the last American heavyweight to unify were either Mike Tyson or Evander Holyfield, one of the two. So I want to be that next to go down in history as the undisputed heavyweight champion of the world, Deontay Wilder. So that's what we're on.
Now, when you're training, do you listen to music, or is there a specific type of artist or genre that gets you hyped when you're training?
Well, up in here, you know, we listen to a lot of old school funk and stuff like that. I bring my radio and I bring my iPod, and we got an old school funk up in here, and we all get in the groove of a lot of artists and music and stuff like that. It just bring a different atmosphere, a different energy to the gym, you know. You know, even the younger people that don't understand who the artist is, but the music just get them that vibe, you know, and start to go, you know. And that's what we use. Most of the time I'm in the gym. That's what I'm listening to. So prepared to come to not really a gym, but a club, because we party up in here. Old school funk, baby, all the way.
All right. Back in high school when I was on the football team, I used to listen to DMX to get me hyped up. And word around the campfire is you do a pretty good DMX impression. You feel like doing that for us here on Real Fans, Real Talk?
Yeah, DMX was one of my favorite fighters, man. I still love DMX and stuff like that. You know, but y'all put me on the spot now. I can't. Dog! See, I can't even do it. You know what I mean?
We'll get you time to prep up a little bit towards the end. You know, compose yourself. I know you weren't expecting it at the end of the interview.
Next. Yeah, you know, I'm just trying to come out. Yeah, you know.
All right, well, I also listened to Jay-Z to get me hype back then. You had an opportunity to sign with Jay-Z and Roc Nation. You decided not to, and staying loyal to Al Haymon. Could you tell us about that?
Yeah, definitely. You know what I mean, I'm loyal to my team, you know. I feel like, you know, even though they offered what they said that they offered and stuff like that, but they really wasn't in a position yet, because the fight didn't go to a person. It didn't go to a purse bid for nobody. It was still negotiating among Golden Boy and Don King Promotion. So, you know, nobody was on the table, was in a position to offer nothing yet, you know. So, by that being said, you know, that was already ruled out. And another thing, I'm loyal to my people, you know. If you don't have loyalty, sometimes you just don't have nothing when you're with a family, you know. You just got to stay by your roots. And, you know, if I went with the first thing I heard or what it deal with money or any other thing, then, you know, I would have been like some of these other knuckleheads out here that lost and getting into lawsuits and, you know, being on the shelf and stuff like that. You know, it takes more than just money to just really to get to me and stuff like that. I got to have a plan. I got to see what's your long-term goal with me, not just no short-term. You know, you can't just come to me a certain type of money and like, okay, this and this. And if you look at it, they was talking about a certain amount of money 5 years. So, you know, really it would have been, for me, it would have been kind of crazy that if I would have signed for $2 million for 5 years, which each fight is supposed to go up, not stay the same or go down. So if I sign my name on the dotted line to get, no matter how big the fight is, small or big, I'm still getting a minimum of what I signed for. Who's it hurting, me or them? It's hurting me in the long run. They still making that money. You know, so when a lot of people see money and they think, oh, there's so much money, you have to think about what is in this contract. What is it gonna benefit me? What is gonna benefit my kids? You know, like, you know, and people just, they all of a sudden go to assumption, this is the most money you made. This is, you know, why you didn't take it? This is, see, that's what people thinking that way, that's when they go wrong. That's when you, if you sign a contract like that, you're setting yourself up for failure.
This is Anthony Mason. You're watching Real Fan, Real Talk, coming at you live from my house.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to another very special edition of Real Fans, Real Talk. I'm Mark the Stat Manskevich. I'm here with the man, the myth, the legend, the one and only Butterbean. Thanks for coming on the program.
Hey, good to be here. Good to be here. Good to talk with y'all.
All right. And interesting story on how you got into fighting in the beginning. There was the series out there, Tough Man Contest, and you kind of started on a little bit of like a dare from colleagues. Can you tell us about that?
Well, all the guys dared me to enter the Tough Man, which I did. Had to lose 20 pounds because I had a 400-pound weight limit. I weighed 420 at the time. And I went on a butter bean and chicken breast diet, and I hated the butter beans. They just got old. They were bland. You know, in the South, you mix grease and other than butter and good stuff and a lot of seasoning, but to eat them healthy, you got to cook them just like it is. And it wasn't so hot. So that's how the Butterbean nickname come on. And it went from there. After I won 18 Tough Men, they told me I couldn't fight in them anymore. And so I said, I want to go pro. I want to go after Tyson. And he never wanted none.
Hey, what's up? This is the WBA middleweight champion of the world, Daniel Jacobs. Keep it here. Keep it locked right here on Real Fans, Real Talk.
There's a huge name like Eminem that started in battle rapping before there was, it's a lot bigger now than it was then, obviously, with the internet and everything. Do you think that a big name like that will ever come back, considering the fact that it's growing?
Well, you know, Eminem did the reality show with us, and he sponsored it, and he watches everything. Mm-hmm. So just for that, we know he pays attention. Will they let him do it? I don't know, bro. Like,
is he, like, there with you guys? Or is he kind of, like, it's
his I personally never met Eminem, but he backed the whole show. Like, it was his reality show.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was his promo behind it. All the perks was there. Rolling Stone did an issue on it. Like, that's crazy. Like, you know, only with his type of approval, you'll get all that. So, you know,
maybe
we got the backing
from something, you know, they're going to steal my idea, but the winner of, like, a tournament gets to battle Eminem.
See, that's the thing about it. Like, now it's at the point where certain names, we're getting booked to the point where it's like, yo, this is our lane. You're not going to come in like Cassidy. Cassidy just battled Disaster. Mm-hmm. Cassidy got $250K.
That's crazy.
But he's got a two-battle contract. He got that. If he would have lost to Disaster, nobody else would get booked like that because we've beaten Cannabis, destroyed. Yeah. Anybody that's tried to come back has gotten destroyed by us.
Yeah.
Cassidy was the only one. And honestly, Cassidy can lose. Like, he can get killed. Like,
it
was the matchup. Yeah, like, he wasn't impressive.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was the guy. Other guy was just worse than he was, you know? So
if he battled anybody from URL, it would have went.
Oh, it would have been. It would have been a nightmare for him. So, like, somebody like Eminem, of course. But are they going to do a tournament? Guys aren't going to do that because we get paid to show up. Like, we're not betting anymore. It's not like a prize after they'll tell. Like, we get booked. They'll be like Cortez.
You still get paid, like, each member in, like,
if the backing is there to do it all, I don't see a problem with it.
Like, if you got eight of the best battle rappers out there, obviously each individual match would be a big thing as it is.
Mm-hmm.
And then as you work to the tournament, the finals is Eminem.
I think that's crazy. Like, I think that's crazy, but I just don't know if they'll let Eminem do it. Maybe another rapper.
He might be too big.
Maybe somebody like Joell Ortiz, Royce da 5'9", the guys that are still respected.
His big name would increase the payday of everybody on the roster.
It would.
And then they could send me a check for coming up with that idea.
Exactly.
Yeah,
but that would be like
right on that quick.
Like M would be crazy. Yeah. That would be everything. The world has to stop. Everyone will buy it. Pay per view will sell out. Everything. So
you might blow
like,
up the internet if M say he was coming back to battle. All right, because usually on the show we have a game show. It's called Shot for Shot. But I'm actually thinking that we should not do shot for shot today because Statman has been working on his bars right now. All right, now he's got his. I tried to coach him. He's a beast unleashed. Cortez, are you willing to step into the ring right here, live on the spot, and battle Mark the Statman Skeptics?
How many bars he has? First,
how many
of
bars you got, Statman?
I got bars for days.
Now, so don't worry if he's top tier, dummy. You know, that's Cortez.
I gotta see. I'm thinking right now. Let me think. Let me brainstorm. I'll line them up.
We'll close out the show if anything.
Say no more.
We still got like another 15 minutes for you to think. We'll do shot for shot. Actually, we'll have you judge.
We'll get you to throw on the ref jersey. The way I know you used to being in the ring.
All right. So how does this go?
The way it works, we ask a series of 5 questions. Unless we go to overtime, whoever the judge agrees with gets the point. If both contestants agree, no point is awarded. The loser of Shot for Shot has to wear team apparel of a team that they hate the following week on Real Fans Real Talk.
Yo, this is Deontay the Bronze Bomber Wilder, heavyweight champion of the world, and you're watching Real Fans Real Talk.
Could you tell us about your performance?
A little bit. I'm from Harlem. In Harlem, you grow up playing basketball. That's one of the prime time things to do when you go outside. So, you know, that's where that stems from.
Now, you're hurting a little bit after the game, it looks like. And in the first half, you came over to the scorer's table. I heard you say, you know, the Danny Glover line, you're too old for this. But and your skills out there were a little bit old school, too. I saw the finger roll. I saw the, you know, a little hook shot there. You use a lot of old school moves all the time when you're out there on the court.
Man, a bucket is a bucket where I'm from, you heard? I bet you I had the most points on the basketball court.
All right, and an overtime thriller, you actually ended up not getting the W, but I guess when you can get all these celebrities to come together for a good cause, everybody wins. Could you tell us about why you got motivated to do Bowling for Peace?
It's for the kids, you know. I like supporting the kids. I like giving the kids something to do, you know, let them know that there's people out here in my position that really wants to give back and show them different things. So, you know, shout out to all the kids that came out to enjoy this event.
Now, I heard you might be interested in getting involved in politics. You're from Harlem. Harlem's changed a lot. Rent rolls going up a lot higher. What's your thoughts on the change in Harlem the past few years?
It's cool. It's called gentrification. It's not as many jobs for the people out of Harlem that I would like to see. But, you know, it makes the neighborhood look good. I come from where every block was abandoned buildings and stuff like that. So to see them starting to put high rises and co-ops and condos and stuff like that, it feels good.
All right. Now, is there anything that you have coming up music-wise or the charity events that are coming up in the near future?
Look for the Diplomat Tour, look for the Diplomat EP, and, you know, same old yayo, man. We out here grinding.
Yeah, Uncle Ralph, you already know what it is. You know what you're doing. Video Music Box, I'm here. Real fans, real talk, and that's the way it's going down. Don't go nowhere. Fix your face. They ain't going nowhere.
If the fight were to happen, Pacquiao versus Mayweather, who do you think would win?
I never predict fights that I might have to keep scoring. So, you know, I'm not partial to one guy or another. It would be a great fight, though. Southpaw against a right-handed guy. Power puncher in Pacquiao against a speed guy in Mayweather. It's a great fight.
Do you think the fight will ever happen?
Oh, definitely. Definitely.
All right. Do you think that Floyd Mayweather will remain undefeated throughout the course of his career?
Well, it looks that way. I mean, you never know. You know, I mean, guys get older. He's 39 already, I believe.
Do you think if Pacquiao gets back to his winning ways that we'll eventually see the fight that everyone was anticipating between Pacquiao and Mayweather?
Well, you know, Mayweather's one of these legend guys. You know, he believes in his legend, what people are going to think of him after he's retired. And really, he's going to have a hard time cementing his legend without fighting Manny Pacquiao. So somewhere down the line, I really think he's going to take the Pacquiao fight.
Eventually, it's going to have to happen. I mean, we waited 5 years for probably the biggest fight in boxing in a long time to happen. And we finally got it, Mayweather versus Manny Pacquiao. Now, we didn't ask everybody that came on the show this question. So we got to ask the champ as well. Who are you taking, Mayweather or Manny Pacquiao?
I'm going to leave it short and simple, you know. I'm not going to go too many explanations. I'm going to leave it short and simple. I think Floyd will win the fight if he do what he have to do because he got some great defense, and he's a different specialist, of course. But I do feel if the fight is any bit close, that the fight, they'll give it to Manny. Like I said again, it's many times where we see a guy dominate a fight, but the judges have another one. I feel like if it be close, they'll give it to Manny. And just think about a rematch, even more money, you know. So you just have to think about it. You know, Manny don't have too much defense. He'd rather punch and then give a punch than anything. So overall, it's going to be a great fight. I'll definitely be there, and I'll be watching. Hope those guys, you know, I hope the hype live up to the fight, you know. I hope, you know, everybody been hyped about this fight for, like you said, 5 years. I hope it don't be like a boring fight. Like everybody been hyped, and he gets like, what the fuck, like, you know. But I think it's gonna be an exciting fight because both, I feel Manny don't have nothing to lose. So I think he's gonna bring it a little bit harder than Floyd because he don't have nothing to lose. I mean, he done lost many a times and stuff like that. Floyd's still living his legacy. He had to live up to his legacy, and that's pressure right there, you know. But I think he'll take it away. So we'll see. That's just my opinion. You know, my little one sitting up in the penny jar. So we'll see what happens.
Right now, we have one of the biggest fights in boxing, you know, in a couple of weeks. Floyd Mayweather versus Manny Pacquiao, 5 years in the making. And we've been going around every person that we've had on the show. We asked them this question. Who you got, Floyd Money Mayweather or Manny Pacquiao?
You know, I know Mayweather. I've never met Pacquiao, but I don't know. It's going to be a tough fight. I think Pacquiao's going to pull it off.
All right. We got one for the Pacquiao side. So, now, do you feel like that boxing is a dying sport?
You know, fights like this bring it back. I mean, it's like this all the time. Normally, it's a heavyweight fight that brings it back, but this fight's brought a lot of attention. What UFC's ever charged $100 plus for pay-per-view? Yeah, boxing's back.
Yeah, definitely. Do you think that it's fair to the fans, though, to charge $100 for a pay-per-view?
Well, if the fighters weren't so greedy making $180 million each, you know, it wouldn't be, but you got to pay them somehow.
All right. And I got to say this because you made your debut on the undercard for the Floyd Mayweather versus Ricky Hatton, another big fight. What was it like just being on the same card as one of the greatest to ever do it?
You know, that's a tremendous opportunity in itself. You know, most guys, when they first turn professional, they don't have an opportunity to fight on a big scale like that. You know, they turn pro in maybe like a club show or somewhere like that, small atmosphere, small audience. But with me, I had the greatest opportunity to fight on the greatest ever, Floyd Mayweather, Ricky Hatton. You know, his fan base was tremendous, so they came over from the UK. It was USA versus the UK. And they were chanting, they were screaming. The energy was amazing, and for me to witness that my first time around, I found a new love for the sport, and you know, it drove me to be at this place where I am now in my career.
One of the more interesting topics and the debated topics nowadays, if you're following boxing, obviously, is Mayweather-Pacquiao, all the drama behind it. Do you think the fight will ever happen, and if it does, who do you think would win?
I don't know what those guys are doing. Had they both trained and kept fighting, and it would have been a pick'ems fight. But I still think it's a pick'em fight. I think they're kind of torn with each other. They going through some changes and stuff. But whoever brings it that night, I think, can win the fight. Either one of those guys can win the fight.
Floyd Mayweather or Manny Pacquiao, if the fight actually goes down, who's going to win?
Well, I would have said about 8 months to a year ago, I would have picked Pacquiao. Pacquiao's not the same fighter anymore. He doesn't have that hop. He just can't do what he used to do. I don't know if it's the personal trainer overtraining him or he's shot. He just don't have it right now, you know.
Mayweather versus Pacquiao, if it ever goes down, who you taking?
Wow. I personally myself, I think, I mean, Floyd just has the style to make it happen because he can capitalize on the mistakes. He doesn't make many mistakes. He doesn't open up. And he sticks with his guns. He'll stick with what works for him until it finally works. Like, he may not, you know, one round, two round, three round, he may be getting outworked, but eventually come the fifth round, sixth round, seventh round, he starts to find the openings, and he's strong all the way through. His reflexes are crazy, and he hits a lot harder than people give him credit for. So, I would see him beating Pacquiao, but Manny at the same time, he can hit hard. He hits from many different angles. He's a southpaw, which I'm not sure if Floyd's seen a lot of him, but I'm sure he'll be able to adapt. It's a great fight, though. It's a great fight.
All right, getting back to boxing, we're going to take one of our fan mail questions. Harold from Brooklyn writes in, is there any fighter that has a legitimate chance of beating Floyd Mayweather? What do you think?
No. I don't think so. I mean,
There's nobody. No, there's nobody out there. I mean, well, Floyd's what, 147 now, 156. I don't know what weight. They go up and down.
Yeah, he's been going. He goes back and forth right. between the two.
So, I don't see nobody doing it right now.
Could you have beaten him during your day?
You know what?
You're from Brooklyn, so I'm going to say yes automatically.
Oh, no, don't get me wrong. I'm more of a sharpshooter as far as like a Tommy Hearns type of style. And it would have been tougher for him because now he's got to come to me. I'm not going to chase you.
Who from your generation would you say compares most to Floyd Mayweather as far as fight styles?
Styles? Fight styles. I would say Pernell Whitaker, but Pernell was much, you couldn't hit him. It's hard to hit. Floyd is not, he's not easy to hit, but you can hit him. Compare him to nobody.
Do you think he would dominate in that generation like he dominates this generation of fighters?
No, no. Too many punchers. Like, you know, Aaron Pryor, guys like Pryor, Tommy Hearns, you know, Ray Leonard. You know, the old-time fighters, you know, you got a guy doing this here. You keep banging him on the arm. They keep going after the man's head. Leave the man's head alone.
Yeah.
You kill this, it's going to go.
So then you think there is a recipe to beat Floyd Mayweather?
Oh, yeah.
Nobody just has been able to figure it out?
Not at all. And, you know, fighters picks who they want to fight today. You know, back when we were fighting, we had to fight who the promoters picked, so it was a little bit easier.
More of a prima donnas nowadays.
Oh, a whole lot of them.
I want to thank Harold for writing in. If you want to write in your fan mail questions, it's fanmail at realfansrealtalk.com.
Face facts, what up? Realfansrealtalk.com. Where Arthur Dom is Trip Young and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan.
Hey, what's up? My name is Grab, baby. Represent this New York City thing to the fullest. Team Bang Dope Gang on deck. And this is Real Fans Real Talk. Respect it.
Talk about, before we get into all that, let me introduce my co-host, who's kind of an unofficial part of the team here, the Glen Cove Cardinals, the one and only Trip Young. What's going on, Trip?
Man, what's going on, Steph? Man, it does feel good. I was at the celebratory highlight viewing party this past weekend where I took some pictures with the trophy, and now it feels good because this is 4 years in the making, and we've been trying to set this up for some time now, but I think it just worked out perfectly that fresh off of a Super Bowl championship in Long Island, that I have the entire team out here, the coaches are here, so I'm looking forward to today's show. We're going to show y'all some of the highlights a little bit later from what these young men did on the field this season. You know, started out a little rough, but they turned it up at the end when they were supposed to and got onto a nice little hot streak leading up into the Super Bowl. A little backstory behind the Super Bowl team that they faced in the Super Bowl, but they definitely showed up. They showed out. And as Michael Strahan said, when the Giants beat the Patriots, they stomped out every other team in the division. And to the victor goes the spoil. So welcome to the show. Welcome to Real Fans, Real Talk.
And that, ladies and gentlemen, is sure as hell not a participation trophy, it's ladies definitely and gentlemen. Not. And it's even bigger than the actual NFL Super Bowl. So congratulations to you guys. As we get things started, we're going to have everybody introduce themselves, what position they play, starting with the coaches, if you could start things off.
Okay, happy to be here. Thanks for having us. Pleasure. We're very excited to pull it off this year. We've been working at it. We came close in other years. But these guys just learned the fundamentals. We told them all season long, focus, discipline, blocking, and tackling. And that's all it took. They came out and hit harder, played harder, and the result is right there.
Your name and your
My name is Philip LaRosa. I'm the head coach. And I'll pass it off to Lenny Parisi, who's an assistant.
Yeah, Lenny Parisi, assistant coach.
That's right.
And I'm Pete Liotta, the assistant coach also.
All right. Now pass it along to the kids. Name and position.
I'm Jason Downer, and I'm a lineman.
I'm Kyle Atelier, and I'm a running back and an outside, left outside linebacker.
I'm Reese Ramos, and I'm a lineman, a defensive tackle, and a defensive end.
I'm Jane Rosario, and I'm the right tight end.
I'm Cooper Schultz, left guard, offensive left guard.
I'm Nick Parisi, middle linebacker.
Wearing LT's number. Sorry to interrupt.
Right tackle and right defensive tackle.
I'm Nick LaRosa. I play halfback, fullback, and right outside linebacker.
Hold up. We're going to have to bring that mic around you. Pull it around your back, Sean. You got to do a magic trick right there. There we go.
I'm Rocco Rainoni, and I play running back and defensive lineman.
I'm Peter Leota, and I'm the quarterback and the right defensive end.
Oh, well, we got the mascot over there.
Yeah, that's cool. I don't know about the mascot, man.
My name's Leo Rainoni, and I'm apparently the mascot.
Well, definitely welcome all of y'all. First of all, the first question, actually, I got to go to the coaches first because I know – you know, I've been on the sidelines for a long time, and I've seen you guys get it heated on the field. How do you guys manage to really cut? Because I know you scale it back a little bit. So how do you manage to keep the calm somewhat during the game? Because I've seen those refs, and it's just like the NFL refs, where they blow some calls, they make some bad judgments out there. So how do you guys keep it calm?
I think it takes a little bit of work to keep it calm. I think a few years under our belt, we've learned to calm down a little bit.
Okay.
When we first started, Rich Borer, who runs the league, wanted to send Pete and I to anger management classes. But in the end, it's all about the kids and trying to set a good example. And that's what we keep on our mind. And I think that's what gets us through it.
Okay. All right. I like that. Now, I'm going to this side. All right, because I'm going back Super Bowl Sunday, 9:00. It was cold that morning, and you guys played against West Hempstead, a team that you guys had a little bit of history with. It got a little crazy in the beginning of the season prior, but everybody managed to keep it peaceful and keep it, you know, keep it to the game. Everybody was good, but you guys completely destroyed them. I mean, I felt like, you know, I know you guys studied the game tapes. But what was it? They just could not do anything. I don't understand. Like, so I'm gonna start with you right here, Nick, since you got the mic in your hand. What was the mindset going into this game?
Well, I think, we had to block hard, tackle, and hopefully just see where they're going and stuff. And we watched a lot of tape for that.
I like that, fellas. All right, and then I'm gonna bring it back around because I'm going to the QB right now, okay? Because I've seen you make some passes that half the quarterbacks in the NFL can't make, and I'm talking about throwing in the triple coverage, and you guys are gonna see some of that in the highlight tape later. And, you know, sometimes it doesn't always work out, but every play you manage to keep your mindset on moving forward in the game. So what is it that goes through your mind when you're on the field? Because I know you guys are in the midget league, but it's still very fast paced. So how do you keep yourself focused?
Well, I watch the defensive players, and I watch if they're blitzing, then I'll audible out of it. And I just try and get the ball off to my running back, and then they'll take it from there.
Sound like I'm playing Madden right now. Audible and blitzing is going
Omaha,
on.
Omaha.
I know. That's young Peyton right there. I like that.
Yeah. It's your boy T-Rex repping that Real Fans, Real Talk. Harlemworld.mall, we in the building.
We back out here. Real Fans, Real Talk. We balling for peace. My man Haran, H2O Hargrave, put this event together. It's the next stop on the Balling for Peace movement. And you see one of the celebs that's going to be playing in the game is an extended family member of the Real Fans, Real Talk team, Anthony Mason Jr. First of all, what's going on, man?
It's pretty hot outside. Just came home from Memphis seeing my family, and I'm coming up here. Feels like I'm still in Memphis, but it's a beautiful day out here for the kids, out here for my man Haran. Good causes, you know, I'm all for the youth, so we just out here to enjoy ourselves.
Well, we're going to make sure we got a lot of water out here for all the athletes that's playing. Now, how did you get linked up with Haran in the whole celebrity flag football game?
I knew Haran from before, just playing ball and stuff out in Queens and stuff. And then I linked up with this girl, Midget, and they hooked me up with this. And I had a couple things I was doing with the kids, starting my little foundation called Family on Three. So I'm all for that push of the youth and speaking back to the youth and doing things for the youth. So once I seen that he was doing a flag football game, you know, I was quick to be a part of it.
All right, now, are you going to be on offense, defense, what quarterback, wide receiver? Because we know what you can do on the courts.
I'm not going to lie. You see me, I'm like, I ain't been to the gym in a minute. So back in the day, you know, I'm all-time quarterback. That's what I was trying to get. Ain't too much moving in flag football when you all-time quarterback. Because I ain't going to pull the move and be out there trying to juke and, my head.
Nah, we ain't going to no Michael Vick in it today.
No.
All right, so we're going to have to make sure he get that QB position out there on the field.
Wide receiver.
That's not fair. You too tall to be wide receiver. We're not gonna do that.
Mawson.
That's not you can't listen. Mawson? If you over 6'5" playing with the regular people, Mawson. You can't be wide receiver. That's not fair. last time we checked in, you was headed overseas. I know you've been playing ball over there. Are you gonna go back overseas or are you gonna stay in the States?
Yeah, I'm staying in the States this year. Got a couple things going, so I'm gonna put my mind and focus into them. A couple things off the court, so into that.
And I know that the acting thing you were doing the part in the web series. How's things coming along with that?
I was going very well. That was one of the little endeavors that I'm into, been acting. We did a project last year called Harlem Nights, and it just got picked up this year for the New York Film Festival in October. So it's big, it's real major. Probably get picked up, you know, pitching it out to networks and stuff. It's a nice little TV series, sitcom that we're pitching about a basketball team out of Harlem.
Okay, and then right now this weekend, in addition to the flag football game, it's also the 50th anniversary of Rucker Park. Are you gonna be playing again this year in the EBC Classic?
Nah,
I know.
I haven't really been inside the gym these days. I've been outside the gym, you know, really talking to the kids, speaking. So I've been taking that approach, been off the court for a minute. So I haven't even been out playing. I haven't even been in the gym. So one of the things I was sitting back on was the EBC. I love to be out there, but I ain't gonna probably make it out there this year. But you know, shouts out to my team, Uwe, all day.
Still the champions from last year though. So y'all still riding off that win. Shout out to team Uwe and all of that. But I ain't gonna take too much time because I know you got to warm up if you are gonna play quarterback or wide receiver out there. You know it's always a pleasure when we get the family on the show.
Get the handshake. You know that mean we cool.
You already know, man. Appreciate you, bro.
It's my birthday, get it out of here. Hey, I'm a sex. One time, get it going.
What's going on? It's Trip Young. We wrapping up. You see Cortez over here all out of breath and whatnot.
Listen, man, we got it washed, man. It is what it is. We got destroyed out there. I was good, though, but, you know, my team, I don't know.
Yeah, Cor had a couple of catches out there. I see he was putting in some work on the defensive end. You know, trying to make it real political right now. But, listen, the blue team definitely lost, but we are balling for peace, and Cor is still winning because he does have that new single out. Y'all saw we played it last week on the live show when Haran came through. You already know, so you definitely winning. Who's the girl that's singing on the track?
Jade Ink from Toronto. She's super talented. I met her down at ATL. She's worked with a lot of big artists herself and shit. Her pen is crazy. So shouts out to Jade Ink, the beautiful Toronto's finest. Y'all gonna hear a lot more of me and her.
Definitely, and the track, it's an amazing track. A lot of times we have situations where people feel like battle rappers can't make good music, but this is actually a good music. And Cor is actually one of the battle rappers that can actually make songs, which is why it's never a problem for us to play his music on the air. I think it's like the it's last two songs we had played on the live show, and we're gonna continue. Anytime we got somebody that's family and is continuing to putting out good product and good music, we're gonna have them.
Genuine. You get what I'm saying? And y'all been genuine, I've been genuine. We building, we working, that's what it is. That's what helps the culture, that's what helps hip-hop, sports, everything, and that's why we here, bro.
So what's next? Summer Madness 5 or something? What's going on?
Warm up, I got Cicero. The day before Smack,
Okay.
That's going to be crazy. I think I got gyms on the RBE card at Purlue September 5th. Y'all should come out for that. That's going to be real crazy. And besides that, I got the 161 album for the Fame's the first single. That should be coming out by mid-September. We're just working, bro. Right now, we in whole promo blast.
Now, are you going to do Cicero as bad as John John did Reed Dollars?
I'm going to do him worse. It's nasty for Sis. I'm telling you right now, it's going to be bad for him.
All right, looking forward to that. And then Jim's, I've been seeing him on the blogs. He's been talking a lot of smack.
I don't know if you saw what I just did to Jay Murda.
Yes, I did.
And that's what's going to happen to Jim.
The funny thing is, I literally just watched it last night, and Core definitely got another one in the bag. You've been on a tear as of late, and I'm kind of upset because
It's not the right level, and it's not the
people that I really want to see you battle. I don't want to say they ducking, but those
ducking.
Are the yeah. Okay,
sir, all right, fine. Arsenal, Clips, who else, man? It don't matter who it is, man. Just put me in that ring. I'ma do work.
We definitely got to see that Clips battle because I ain't like the way he called you out in that Hollow the Dome battle.
Right, but he know what's up.
Yeah. But you know what? That's the, at the end of the day, it's all a chess game. So I'm sure those matchups will be coming soon. And in the meantime, you're just gonna keep killing who's ever in front of you.
Facts. That's all I'm gonna do.
Really quick before we get a battle, because I know everybody tired. Just tell them. I mean, I'm sure they know already, but give them the Twitter, the Instagram, all of that.
Cortez_HSP, that's the Twitter, that's the Instagram. Cortez Politics for the Gmail. I respond to the fans. Let's talk. Let's do business. Let's do what it is, man. No days off. Murder App Gang is the movement. Y'all know what it is, man. NYB Gangster.
And make sure y'all get that. Y'all check out that video because it's a dope track.
Make sure y'all subscribe to the YouTube. YouTube.com/Cortez MURDAAV3. Cortez Murder Ad, but the E is a 3. That's it. Subscribe, build, let's work.
Yo, Brooklyn, we out here, man. You already know. It's all love, man. Appreciate you, Cole.
Ballin' for peace.
Hi, I'm Holt McCallany, and you're watching Real Fans, Real Talk.
Right here.
Ladies and gentlemen, here live with Coney Island styling, Brooklyn Zone, D Chambers, me personally born on Coney Island as well. There you go. So before we get into your career, we're talking about the Super Bowl. Big game this Sunday. Every man in the world out there is excited. The girls are outside excited for the Super Bowl. And a lot of parties going on. People are excited about even the commercials. Excited about everything. Big game, big matchup. Tom Brady versus Russell Wilson and the Seahawks Legion of Boom defense. Great game. Might have our first back-to-back Super Bowl champion in 10 years. Before myself and Tripp Young give our official predictions, we're going to have our guests do the honors first. Who do you got in the big game?
I got my money on the Seahawks. I got my money on them. I don't know. It's just the chemistry.
Yeah.
And I say I'm a basketball kind of guy, and I'm into boxing, but as far as the football, I'm going with the Seahawks this year. I predicted who was going to win last year, and they won last year.
All right. There you have it. Seahawks Legion of Boom defense, you think is going to shut down Tom Brady and the Patriots?
I like the Patriots. I don't want to talk too bad about that. You know what I mean? I like the Patriots.
It is a tough call.
I like the Patriots.
This is one I'm probably staying away from as far as the betting is concerned.
See, so you can stay away from it, but I got to answer it.
I'm going to get my official prediction, but I'm not sure if I'm going to throw money on it. But
I got money on the Seahawks. Tom Brady is a good player, but I'm going to say the Seahawks.
All right, Tripp Young, your official prediction.
You know, go with my man Tom Too Cool, man.
Because he's too cool?
That's why, because he's too cool.
That's why they might lose.
No, he got Gronkowski back healthy. You know, they're gonna do some damage. And Darrelle Revis, he want to show that he's the best cornerback in the league. It's not Richard Sherman. I mean, I still think so, too. But, you know, it is what it is. But I'm going with the Patriots on this one. But like I said, if the Seahawks win, you know, Russell Wilson is still only the second, you know, African-American quarterback starting in the Super Bowl to win it. So I still got to support that either way.
All right. Keep in mind, your name is Flip Young. So while you're young, you still can flip it.
Well, it's Tripp Young. Trip, so it's not Tripp. You're going to flip my name.
You tripping anyway.
I might be flipping.
So he's just riding.
Yeah, all right. I got you. But we definitely, you know, it's going to be a great game either way. I'm looking forward
with
to it.
With the Raiders hat on. Next.
That's the name. I'm from Brooklyn, though. So I still
got to okay, cool. I can make sure. Man. I had to make sure.
All right, but my official prediction, I'm going with Tripp Young on this one. I'm not a Patriots fan. I'm not a Tom Too Cool fan at all. But he's just got too many weapons. Gronkowski out there healthy, who's just a beast, and almost seems like it doesn't matter who's on him. He's just catching over people's heads. And even if they do shut him down, you have Edelman, you have Brandon LaFell, you have Amendola, who makes an appearance if everyone else is shut down. So you have that offensive line that gives Tom Brady a year and a half to throw and makes every single running back that they throw out there have a great game because they're just a good passing block.
And this is not Peyton Manning. He does not throw ducks.
Yeah, so
he can actually throw down the field.
Also, he has some failures.
Also,
he's playing Eli, but, you know, that's different.
On the flip side of it, you know, the Seahawks defense is great, but at the same time, I think that their offense against the Patriots defense, I think it's probably going to be a low-scoring game. You know, probably I'm going to say maybe 10 to 17 in favor of the Patriots. That's what I'm going to call it. Low-scoring game. I think the offense on the Seahawks side doesn't have that many weapons other than Marshawn Lynch, and the Patriots defense is good against the run, good against the pass. As Tripp Young mentioned, Revis Island, not that many great receivers on the Seahawks. So I think that the Patriots will come up. But, I mean, like I said, I wouldn't put money on
it.
It's
half and half.
It's too close to call.
You just said a lot of good things for the Patriots.
I mean, if I had to put money on it, I would go with the Patriots. There's a lot of fans out there who you know, hopefully won't be disappointed because if you're saying you got your money on the Seahawks, I don't know.
I have a feeling.
Oh, okay.
Money and the feeling is two different
okay,
things.
I just want to make sure. There's a lot of fans out there who are hating the Patriots right now with the Deflategate and might be putting their money on the Seahawks and, you know, bet what you had, not what you hate, I always say.
But the Patriots do have strong defense and they're good runners. But I think overall the Seahawks are here to make an impact and they're here for a reason. You know, if Josh was here, we'd be talking about the Giants, but too bad they wasn't.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a diehard Giants fan myself, obviously, native Brooklynite, go with the New York team, and I'm sure Tom Brady is happy that Eli Manning is not in the Super Bowl, that's for sure, because, you know, he'd be getting another Super Bowl L added to his list. But let's go into your career, growing up in Coney Island. What got you started into rapping?
What got me into music actually was always being around it. I was one of those dudes who actually, you know, I was the gift and the curse. I could have even went to the streets. I went to college, you know. You have the best of both worlds. I felt like kind of like Kyle Watson out there. It's like you're fighting for a positive core, but you're surrounded by negativity. So once it was a group of people that came together and said, yo, let's just start playing with this music, let's do it. And this was in between times of just trying not to go to jail, like just the minor stuff. Like, we went to school, we went to stuff, but it's just certain negative stuff in Coney Island you cannot dodge. It's just that the environment is just totally different. And at that time, my boy Liaison, he was the one who always had the management. And the first time Smack came to the neighborhood, that was like a claim to fame. And I always was supporting him, and I always was rapping while I was caught up in the middle of things. But then when I caught my gun charge, you know, I don't brag on these things, but I talk from experience. It gave me time to, you know, I actually beat it, and I say, you know what, this is going to keep me away from all the other stuff, because, you know, out of sight, out of mind. So once I started doing music and connected with a lot of other people that was making moves doing music, I took it more seriously. But then already had still not having enough of the streets, I caught a light bid, and I think that whole 06, 07, I was gone. I just was just reading about, just reading magazines like the XXL, reading. I did a bunch of shows before I went in. So a lot of stuff I did before I went in, but it was too late. But I knew exactly what to do when I came home. And being from Coney Island, a lot of people just know Coney Island for basketball and the movie The Warriors. So
I'm just going to say, because you have the Warrior Project
right
out there.
But see, it's funny. When I always wore a Coney Island hat. I never wore too many team hats. If it wasn't the Yankees, if it wasn't the Mets here and there, because it matched, it was just a Coney Island hat. And I always said, nobody from Coney Island ever had a brick musically. And I think it became that because some people were just happy with what was going on in the comfort zone. And it happens to even New York artists, because once you burn down New York, you got to go to other states. So, but Coney Island, nobody leaves. It's one way in, one way out. A lot of people just find excuses to make things. So when I came up with The Warriors and really reflected it to the movies, like, because the first thing in the movie, The Warriors went out to make something happen. They went to go hear the word and still wound up in tons of trouble and had to fight for their way back. So that's like the same mentality I use towards music, is to go out there. And if by any means, whatever needs to get done to get known and get heard, and remember, like, Coney Island could stand on its own for whatever talent it is and just recognize us, you know, that's why I go hard for it. And I think within the last 2 years, maybe three, people has respected Coney Island more now. It's a topic. And the first thing they say is like, yo, you know D. Chambers? They already know Coney Island.
Yeah, because you're definitely, like, I've noticed the last 2 years, I mean, especially now, you got the Shake the Block. We just saw that with Uncle Murda.
Right.
You got a lot of joints with Fred the Godson.
Right.
You got second Chinks.
One. Chinks.
You got Chinks on there. So it's not, you know, it's not like Joe Smoke from the block on it.
But
like,
I'll be honest with you, a lot of my fame also came not only just for a lot of shows that I did on the underground level. I did a lot of open mics. Like, I still go back to those places, like the Pyramid.
You got an underground music award.
Yeah, the UMAs. Oh. Yeah, 2012. I got a couple awards in short time.
Come on, man. That's
in short time.
UMA in 2012 was like the big stepping.
That was BB King. That was BB King's. Cause I'm not gonna lie, 2011, I made a big fuss about it. And I was just like, how much things do I need to do with no budget to get recognized even in the underground?
What's up? This is DJ Enough. Heavy hitters, and you're checking out Real Fans, Real Talk. Three, two,
hello, everyone. Mark the Statman Skevich, Real Fans, Real Talk, here at the 50th anniversary of Rucker Park, here with one of the iconic legends in women's basketball, Teresa Witherspoon. Thank you for coming on the program.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
All right. Now, you've had a lot of accomplishments in the sport of basketball, a coaching career, playing career, Olympic gold medalist. What would you say is your biggest moment in your career?
I can't pinpoint that. That's really, really difficult to pinpoint. The biggest thing and the greatest thing for me is the opportunity, because you have to take a true advantage of an opportunity. So it's been just great to have an opportunity to play a game that I was gifted at playing and love so very much at playing. But it's never a one thing when it comes to the game. It's the opportunity and taking advantage of the opportunity.
Now, you're one of the pioneers of the WNBA back in 1997 when the league started with the New York Liberty. What was that feeling like, being there, one of the first to ever do it?
Man, you know, it was amazing to play in Madison Square Garden. I'm sure it was amazing for all the other young ladies and the teams in which they played for, but we were playing in New York City. We were playing in Madison Square Garden. We were playing in front of the greatest fans there is in the world. So it was an exciting moment for us all to be able to play back in America and play a game we love in America, because we were all basically overseas playing, because that was our dream, was to be able to play, continue after college, and we played overseas. But to come back in America and be chosen to play in New York City in Madison Square Garden, that was the greatest feeling in the world.
Now, when did you fall in love with the sport of basketball?
I was very young. I'm from a family of nothing but athletes, and I'm the baby. So I had to fall in love some kind of way, but they said I picked up a ball at 4 years old and just started playing with it. And my family, brothers and sisters, pushed me with the game of basketball and many other sports, because I'm from a very small place. So all I did was play every sport possible with the guys all the time.
Now, growing up as a kid, did you ever think imaginable that there would be a WNBA and that you would be playing for them?
Well, you know, we never imagined that. We were trying to take advantage of the opportunities that were before us. And the ultimate at that time was to be an Olympian. So everybody was shooting to be an Olympian, and that's only 12. You only get 12 of those, so it was limited space, so to speak, for all the athletes, women, great athletes, in the game of basketball. So that was the ultimate for us. And then if you wanted to play collegiately, you had to go overseas. So it was trying times at points, but to have the WNBA come into existence because of our 96 Olympic team, showing everybody that women can play this game, we play it at a very high level, and we're professionals.
you were a little bit of a late bloomer, so to speak, but so was Michael Jordan. During your early college career in high school, weren't necessarily a superstar, started blossoming later in the college years. What's your opinion as far as the league changing the rules of players being drafted out of high school?
Well, I understand that physically some of the guys are ready to perform at that level. You know, you got some kids who are just gifted athletically and gifted, and from a skill standpoint, for me, growing up in a smaller town and going to a small college, it allowed me to really work on my skills and really, you know, work on my craft at a level where it wasn't as competitive, but being able to do a lot of the things I could really helped me for the next level. So, you know, it's great for these kids to go earlier at 19 and 20 and 18. But, you know, one of the things I worry about is their maturity in the game. And will they be able to understand the game and learn on the fly? Because once you get to the NBA, it is about development, but it's also about money and it's also about winning games. It's a little bit different than college and high school.
Now, speaking of getting into the NBA, what was that like for you getting drafted in the first round by the Bucks?
It was an amazing feeling. One of the top five moments of my life is to, and I actually didn't know I was going to go to the Bucks, so that even added to it, being in the green room with my mother and my father. And just a dream come true, all the hard work that had paid off, and to finally have that moment. It was just the beginning of the dream, though.
Now, getting to the NBA, I'm blossoming early in the NBA career, a four-time NBA All-Star, but what was it like stepping out on the court? I'm sure you were a fan of some of the guys that you're playing against, maybe Michael Jordan, or what was that like being on the court with some of the guys as a teenager that you watched play?
Terrifying. My first few times being on the floor with these amazing stars, you know, seeing Michael and seeing Patrick, Karl Malone, I was just in awe. But I had to get out of awe really fast because they were kicking my butt in the first year. But once I got the game down, and being in awe, I also was studying how to get better. And so my first experiences were in awe, but, you know, probably 8-9 months into it, I was ready to compete at a high level.
Now, you were obviously great, but you weren't necessarily, didn't have the luck of being on a serious contender. You went to the Sonics after they were in the finals. Like, do you kind of regret that you never got the chance? We see a lot of times nowadays players like Kevin Love going to contenders and taking a contract break. Do you think, you know, do you regret some of that you weren't able to play for a contender?
Well, my first year in Seattle, we won 61 games. We were 61-21. So we still, you know, we're the number one team in the West. You know, I don't regret, you know, any things with my career as far as playing on a contender. I thought that team could have definitely contended for a championship. We were eliminated by the Lakers, who were a very good team at the time as well. But I understand these guys making moves. The wonderful part about the game today as far as making moves contractually and going to winning teams is teams are able to fulfill the contract as well as put together a good team. You know, it was a point in the 90s where you only had two players who could make max contracts. Now you have four and five players who are demanding max contracts, and that's where the money is. So you do have an opportunity not only to play and get your max dollar, but also play on a team that's potentially a contender. I think you have about 12 to 15 teams that have a possibility of winning a championship this year.
I mean, we've seen the Knicks as an 8 seed make the finals. We've seen other 8 seeds make the finals. So as long as you're in the dance, you could definitely make it. Now, speaking of the Knicks, you had a short tenure with the Knicks, but you played high school in Connecticut and college in Connecticut, so it's kind of the local team. So was that, even though it wasn't your first team or your last team or the longest team, was the Knicks hold a special place in your heart?
Oh, absolutely. I have like two or three great moments that I had here at the Garden that rank in my top 20 moments in basketball in my life. One of them was playing here at the Garden and getting a standing ovation in the playoffs against the Nets. Coming off the court and getting a standing ovation was one of the top moments of my life in basketball. So the Knicks will always have a special place in my heart. It's the mecca of basketball, and like you alluded to and mentioned, that I'm from Connecticut, right down the road, so I know all the history of the sport, of the game here in the city, and in the Knicks, of course. So just being part of this organization has been amazing. It's a blessing to have them have me come back and give back to the city of New York.
Now, speaking of history, obviously Rucker Park, huge history, 50 years. Do you have some moments in Rucker Park, some of your favorite moments? Or
I think I didn't play here, but I think my favorite moment, more of the recent moments, is when Durant came here and I...
RealFansRealTalk.com. Where Arthur Thomas, Trip Young, and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend a CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. RealFansRealTalk.com got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Is Jeremy Lin hurt?
We'll log onto the site and you can hear it from them first.